Hey, there it is. You got it.
Okay, Hal, let's slate it. 44.
You are now tuned into the Truth Frequency.
We are TFR. TFR.
Truth Frequency Radio.
Broadcasting straight to you from a large spaceship, currently heading down to Disney World for some rest and relaxation. Wait, what do you mean there's something happening in Orlando? Oh man, not one of those sideshows. Will they ever learn? Guy walks in and literally shoots 100 people. That'll be the day. Hello everyone, and welcome to Strange World, where the truth is often stranger than fiction. I'm your host, Mark Sargent, the creator of Flat Earth Clues, which propose that all of us are living inside a Truman Show enclosed structure thousands of miles wide. Check it out at marksargent.com, enclosedworld.com, or just Google Flat Earth Clues. If you can't find it, you're probably trying to take into account the curvature of the Earth. That is 8 inches per mile squared, and that's just not going to work for you. For those of you listening to this on YouTube and want to hear the show live as it happens, please go to Truth Frequency Radio for the latest schedule. Currently, the show is on Tuesday nights at 7 Pacific, 10 Eastern. Quote of the day comes from Brian Burton, who says, "We can lick gravity, but sometimes the paperwork is overwhelming." Who said that? But not only, it was Wernher von Braun. So that's kind of fun. Before I open up the phone lines and start reading emails and going over whatever is happening in the flat earth world, I'd like to read to you an interesting article that came across my desk today. For those of you who know, not only to go into YouTube and type in flat earth and say that, just check out, hit daily and see what's going on there. But I also go into most of the major search engines and type in flat earth and hit the news button and see if any interesting news stories. And sure enough, a really interesting news story came up today, June 14th. 2016, and it's got various titles depending on who covered it, but I like the one from motherboard.vice.com, which is "A Flat Earth Argument in Small Town Ontario Turned into an Actual Garbage Fire." And the article is fairly short, but I would like to read it to you real quick. "One of the weirder elements to emerge from today's mainstream conspiracy culture is the contention that the Earth is, in fact, flat. This has made some people very mad online, the most mad being serial splainer Neil deGrasse Tyson. But on Monday night, at a campsite in the town of Brockville, Ontario, near Toronto, an argument about the shape of the Earth reportedly turned into a literal garbage fire. According to local reports, the 56-year-old man who maintained that the Earth is round got so mad at his son's flat Earth truther girlfriend that he started to throw things into the fire, including a propane canister. The fire department was called to put out the blaze, but the man left the scene. The man is still being sought by police, according to the local media. They intend to charge him with mischief. But a representative from the Brockville Police Service could not be reached for comment." As for how the debate tactic of going apeshit and throwing everything you can get your hands on into a fire pit went, police say that neither party would change their views. According to a local radio station, 580 CFRA, since the incalcitrant debate about the shape of our planet has been raging for thousands of years, I wouldn't have expected any other outcome. And that was written by Jordan Pearson, staff writer out of Canada. Very, very interesting story, I think. And some of the titles, the variations of the titles, like the Huffington Post wrote, Brockville Flat Earth Fight Winds Up in Fire, and that's a great joke. Let's see, man charged in Ontario after fight over whether the earth is flat or round. Police and firefighters called in after flat earth debate turns heated. You can see where this goes, right? You know, another one, heated dispute over earth shape leads to fire in Brockville. Brockville police seek suspect involved in flat earth fight. It's just good press. That's good media right there. Seriously, shop around. You can't beat that for I mean, it cost them almost nothing. You can imagine the fight. And again, the people that get the most mad, it aren't the flat earthers. The flat earthers are fairly calm. You know, we're the ones that are going to people saying, look, man, it could be flat. You just got to embrace it, you know? It's the other people that just lose their freaking minds. And this one is kind of fun. So anyway, thank you for the person that sent me the initial tip on that headline. And by the way, yes, it turns out I was using my headphone backwards, so the microphone is now on the other side of my face. If I am coming in too puffy or if the sound's not quite right, please email me or shoot me a thing during the show, and I will correct it as best I can. Okay, what else before we get to this? Oh, yeah. Well, I'm reading off the phone number. Well, read off the phone number first, and that is 720-897-6111. 720-897-6111. I've just added voicemail to this line, by the way. And so, meaning voicemail, I actually have an outbound message. I had forgotten that I could actually do that. So now when you call after 15 seconds, it's not just going to keep ringing. It will go to voicemail after 15 seconds. It's up to you if you want to leave a voicemail. I'm not going to answer those and then try to call you back during the show. So you're just going to have to call back a different time. But since I gave the phone number out, I've got to mention, because we're going, I don't know how many weeks I've done this, 3 or 4, the Jeffrey Grubb Debate Challenge. I know that David Weiss had recently gone up against, I can't remember whatever the guy's name is, from the Postal Service. The Postal Service, you know, contends that the Flat Earth movement, I'm sorry, the Flat Earth Awakening is just a giant psyop and everybody's in on it and it's a distraction from real conspiracies. And David proceeded to just work him into the ground. It would have been nice if Jeffrey could have debated him, but this was strictly, you know, between David and the guy from the Postal Service. But Jeffrey Grupp, big brain, big head from zeteticism.com. He is looking for anyone to debate on this. You got to have a website or you got to have a YouTube channel or something. You know, you can't just be anybody. He'd love a scientist. He'd love someone from anyone in mainstream science. Remember, as far as the Flat Earth is concerned, he is the backroom bar brawler. He's got a broken pool cue in his hands. I think he's got a broken pool cue in both hands. And he's just waiting. He's just looking for someone to take on. Because nobody's stepping up to the plate. And if I'll be the first one to say that, because not only have I interviewed, 17 people now already, testimonial shows, people that have come out and said, yeah, what you're saying is right. The world isn't what we think it is. Not only have none of those people recanted, but nobody has come out against them. You would have thought, since I covered all bases from the, how did I get a phone call and I didn't see it? I'm sorry. Whoever is 334 area code, please call back. And I will answer it. Sorry, I didn't have a notification turned on, so I wasn't looking at my screen. Sorry, I was looking down. So 334 area code, please call back. Where's it going with this? Not only has nobody recanted, but nobody has come out against it from the professional sector. So nobody from the Army, Navy, Air Force, Marines, no structural engineers. The closest we got was a geodetic surveyor, but honestly, they're about the same as an astronomer, because remember, an astronomer, they're going to come out because their whole livelihood is based on the solar system being real. Same thing with the geodetic surveyor. The geodetic surveyor, the world has to be a sphere. If it is not a sphere, they don't get up in the morning. Plain and simple. So anyway, phone number, of course, 720-897-6111. And The email I'd like to read, I'm going to read, I don't do this usually, but somebody wrote me something and I actually typed back a response to him, and I thought it'd be kind of helpful if I read both. It's not long. So Andrew writes, "Hey Mark, loved your videos. Thought-provoking. I'm a philosophy major and love a good debate. I kind of doubt we could even understand Copernicus, no less debate him. But here's my question, or rather my fiancé's question." Oh, sure, try to get out of it. "The common denominator question, as with any conspiracy, is the age-old question, why? What would be the purpose of such a secret? Sincerely, Andrew Packard, schoolteacher. P.S. Do you seriously advocate I not teach the globe to my students?" Oof. Okay, so that's why I answered him. And I answered him with this. Andrew, thanks for reaching out. I think all of us have a sense of right and wrong, or as I like to say, constructive or destructive. No one is perfect, and mistakes are made, of course. But did you learn anything from them? The easy question to ask would be, would you subject, whatever it is, to your own child or family member? The judge may in this case be a higher version of yourself or a fragment of God. I don't want to get too out there with this thought. The purpose may help answer it. I have believed for a long time that this place is part school, part ride, part perspective, recharge room. Everyone here seems to suffer in some degree regardless of status, which hints that the outer world is the opposite. How can we know bliss without suffering, light without shadow, etc.? Or to put it another way, the purpose here has to be elusive. Otherwise, no one would stay. Hope this helps a bit." And that was my response to Andrew. Plus, I got to throw in a little thing at the end. No, no, you've got students. No, the education system would throw you out in 2 seconds if you said that the world was flat and not a globe. I mean, yeah, if you've got a backup career ready to go, sure, take a shot. But, you know, if you're going to do it, I'd be more dramatic. You know, I'd contact a local press, go out with a bang. Don't, you know, or go out at the end of your tenure. Don't start teaching the globe to the kids, because remember, I mean, this is one of the reasons I couldn't become a teacher, which is there's a lot of history alone that I would be correcting people on, which is why I'm doing these big rants on MarkSargent.com. My take on just about every war the Americans have ever fought, the Revolutionary War, the Mexican-American War, the Spanish-American War, the Battle of Pearl Harbor. All this stuff is nothing. Nothing is what it's they say it is. History is not only written by the winners, but Napoleon said it best when he quoted as saying, "History is just lies that are agreed upon." So let's move on, shall we? Clockwork writes, "Hi, I'm a software developer from Niagara, Canada. I write iOS apps professionally. My idea is this: make an iOS and Android app that will simply allow the user to take a picture, but the idea is to take a picture of the sun. The device will record the photo, the location, and the angle of the device pointing at the sun, and then send all this information to the website/server. The server keeps this information and can do any number of things to calculate the location of the sun. The more people that use the device and the more often they take a picture, the more accurate the location and speed of the sun would be. To encourage its use, the app could allow the user to publicly display their photos. Other users can comment on their photos. The app can have a moon mode also. The idea will require both a client and a server application. There must be a fair number of logistics. The client app must require location tracking and have a gyro to express device angle. It should have an offline mode to allow the user to take a photo while not connected to the network and queue them for transmission later. The server application must be able to handle a huge number of concurrent connections, hopefully. Power to process incoming images, user management, allow other users to flag report images that are not of the sun and the moon, perhaps even run some simplistic AI artificial neural network that can sift out genuine photos of the sun and moon. What do you think, Michael?" It's pretty good, Michael. And actually, there's some people that are already suggesting, you know, tracking the sun and the moon is going to be the best way to figure out where we are. I don't know. Again, for me, it's tough because it's not for, don't forget that in order to help accommodate the 100th monkey effect, you're going to have something that appeals to the lowest common denominator. And by that, I mean people that don't do math and don't know angles and don't know really anything. Imagine somebody that never even made it to high school algebra, because that's a lot of us. And So I mean, it's good. I just don't know if it's going to be the convincing thing. Even if you had that app and all these apps pointed out and said, "Oh yeah, that the sun is coming at a certain angle, therefore it has to be only 3,000 miles away and only be 30 something miles across," the super nerds are going to come back and say, "Well, you built the app wrong, or some of the data is flawed." They're going to hit it from six different ways and create enough reasonable doubt that you're, I don't know if you're going to have much left standing there, but. Never know. It's possible, I suppose. Question from Garrett. "Hey, Mark, I'm a 40-year-old South African male. I am a trained medical doctor. I have a very open mind and have been discovering many conspiracies within my own field of practice, including the true cause of many diseases like cancer and diabetes. I believe that the truth will set us free, and my life changed after a video series on intelligent design and the lies taught about the evolution of life. So I am a Christian who believes that we are created by God, and I believe that the earth is only a few thousand years old. I believe that the flood was a real event and that the Tower of Babel is a true historic event. In my worldview, I never really considered a flat earth until seeing your video on YouTube. I am very intrigued and stimulated by how your mind works. I have a science teacher for a dad, and my brother will absolutely ridicule any mention of this, but then he believes everything he is told, from the fact that fluoride is good for your teeth to the safety of GM foods to getting his flu shot every year. I have a question for you, if you'll indulge me. You do touch on this in Chapter 9 of your series. I have seen advertised flights from Johannesburg, South Africa, and Perth, Australia in about 9 hours. As you mentioned, these flights are rare, and most fly to the Middle East, Qatar first, which wouldn't make sense on a flat Earth. Even if the flights are not trackable with GPS, how does this flight in only 9 hours work on a flat Earth, as it is the opposite side of the world? If you don't mind, I'll probably contact you again with some questions after I've spent more time on this topic. I have only really done a few hours of light research on this, and as you yourself mentioned at the beginning of your series, this has been something I have always shunned away from, thinking that it was impossible. I would very much like this to be true. It is for this very reason that I am unfortunately biased and may miss the truth if I am not careful. Regards, Garrett Gouws, G-O-U-W-S. Yeah, Garrett, when it comes to the flights in the Southern Hemisphere, I'm not exactly sure why the times work out. There's something wrong with the map, no question. The only map we really have to go off now, because it is the best kept secret ever, is the UN flag and the azimuthal equidistant map and the perspectives we're given there. Some people have tried to rewrite the map, and you know we're working on the proportions and the scale. One day we may get the scale correct. Until then, we're just going to have to deal with some of the inconsistencies that are out there. I don't really have a better explanation than that. I mean, some people will say, you know, it's speed of the airplane. Some will say that the map segments, when you get out that far, are actually condensed. I don't know. I don't know yet. But we'll figure it out one day. So don't worry. Number again to call is 720-897-6111. Hopefully the phone is working tonight. I think so, because I actually got a voicemail from 334 area code. So if you are listening now, 334, that's a minute, 29 seconds. If you are listening, please do call me back. For anyone else out there who's listening to this live on Truth Frequency Radio, real people, real radio, yeah, call in when you get a chance. Hopefully it's still working, because I activated call forwarding from my phone, so that's piping through as well. So if I get a weird phone call, from somebody that you know, seems like they're just calling. I mean, just about everybody that calls my normal phone wants to talk about flat Earth anyway. But some of these people that call in may not know they're on the air. We'll find out. Gemma writes, "Dear Mark, I hope this finds you well. At the start of the year, my partner Tristan Ransley, well, that's a great name, Tristan Ransley, emailed you in regards to night vision binoculars. You replied and recommended some to him. I would like to surprise him with some for his birthday, but do not know which ones to get." Hopefully Tristan is not listening to this show. If he is, well, cat's out of the bag now. "I do not have a fortune to spend, would like to get the best available to me. Would you be able to send me some links and a few options? I would ever be so grateful. I look forward to your response. Kind regards, Gemma Dobson." I believe Gemma is in England, because Tristan and Gemma are both English names. Yeah, Gemma. And I don't, hopefully, The UK doesn't have a problem shipping them because I know that you're not supposed to carry night vision when you're flying overseas. So like if I was in the United States and I was flying to somewhere in Europe, I know they don't like you to carry night vision over there. I don't know exactly why, because most of it comes from Russia anyway, more specifically Belarus. The ones I recommend right now, and I went through a lot of night vision. I'm not exactly, I'm not getting paid by these guys, is Night Owl. They're the brand, and they make a 5X. That's probably the most powerful you can get. They go down to like 3X, but 5X is about the most powerful you can get. Binoculars, not a monocular, because everybody's got one eye is a little bit stronger than the other, and you can adjust them individually. And I went through several different types. Some that were way more expensive, a couple grand. You can spend up to $3,000-$4,000 on night vision. These run you about $400, which is real reasonable. They're Gen 1, and people are wondering, what's the difference between Generation 1, Generation 2, Generation 3 night vision? The biggest difference is that by Generation 3, when you can kind of tell between friend or foe. So if somebody's walking up to you, that's military tends to use Generation 3. They're clearer at short distances. So if somebody's walking up to you, they don't look like this fuzzy person. You accidentally shoot them. They look really clear, and you can figure, oh, that's my buddy Fred. I should not shoot him. Generation 1 is though fine for looking up in the sky and looking at stars. It's just fantastic. I really recommend it highly. And that's weird. I'm getting phone calls that are coming in, but I can't. It's like a 206 area code just called in. It blinked off. 206, if you're trying to call in, call again. 206-782-6037, I think. That's weird. Hopefully these calls aren't going straight to voicemail. Maybe I'll crank up the at the break, I'll crank up the delay time from like 15 seconds to like 25 seconds. Maybe. Because I don't think they're hearing enough rings by the time they get to me. Anyway, number to call, we're going to read a few more things before the break, is, of course, 720-897-6111. That is 720-897-6111. And I think that's exactly what's happening. I think these phone calls are not getting in. So what I'm going to do? I'm going to do this while I'm on the air right now. And go on to options. I'm going to calls. And I'm going to go to voice messages. Yeah, that's exactly what's happening. People aren't. We're going to up this thing to like 30 seconds. And we'll say, if I'm already on a call, no. Oh, that's what's happening. I'm already on a call. That's what it is. All right, we'll take this down, back down to like 20 seconds. That's what's happening. I said if I was already on a call to immediately forward it to voicemail. I'm sorry, guys. 206, call in one more time. I accidentally hit a button that said if I'm already on a call, technically, which I am, then immediately route everything to voicemail. And here's a call coming in right now. Add to group call. You are on live with Strange World. And that is not taking either. Why? Because I don't have enough. I can't do. Wow. You know what? That's okay. We'll just keep working with this. Sorry, guys. I'm trying to work through the system. I think I know what's happening. I may not be able to take calls on this, or I may. We'll see. Anyway. This one's from Stefano. Stefano says, hello, Mark. My name is Stefano, and I'm a flat earther. I have a question and would be pleased to know your opinion. What do you think about sea tides? Thank you. Yeah, I've answered this one before, but the might as well dig into some of these old ones again, which is sea tides. The general science opinion is that they are controlled by the gravity forces, the weaker gravity forces of the moon. And I don't believe that's the case at all, because the moon is actually, if you're following the flat Earth model, and the moon is only, 30-something miles wide, and it's only a couple thousand miles up, there's no way it's going to have enough gravitational force or magnetic force or electromagnetic force to affect anything. So it's everything that's happening down with the tides is being controlled below. Maybe a combination of electromagnetic systems, because seawater is also conducts electricity. And, also could be a pressure-based system, could be also part of the underwater conveyor system. Who knows? But I don't think it's being controlled by the moon. So it's being controlled below by probably several systems. Hopefully that helps. Les writes, "This is the most incredible info I've ever seen. Thank you." Thank you, Les. That's awesome. I love emails like that because they're super short. Raymond writes, "Just want to thanks for creating great videos and even the ideas on how to show the real world to us. Keep up the great work, and I will do my best to spread it in hopes of helping those people who still walk this plane with their eyes wide shut." Thank you, Raymond. It's always good to hear. Love the kind words. Very, very much appreciated. And yeah, don't forget, the first rule of Flat Club is that you do not talk about Flat Club. So size up the people you're going to talk to. Don't, be careful you're going to talk to. I've got a friend who's a psychiatrist who I spoke with earlier today, and she said that she brings it up for fun every once in a while. You know, because psychiatrists like, dealing with people that are considered insane, and conspiracy people often, are on that cusp, but they're on that fringe. And she brings it up with them every once in a while and just to see what their reaction is. And it's always the same, because these are guys who've had, their bachelor's and their master's and their doctorates, and they're already in private practice. They've got that scientific mind, even though they don't have a degree in a geology or hydrology or any of the ologies, or astronomy, even though that's not an ology. Interesting, though, isn't it that astronomy isn't an ology, but astrology, that's not an actual real science? Just thought of that just now. Interesting. 1 minute till the break. When we come back, hopefully I'll get the freaking phone lines working. Do we have time for this one? Yeah, let's try this real quick. It's from Ontario. Hey, Mark, the Flat Earth YouTube videos I watched all indicated the first picture of Earth was taken from space in 1972. I was researching the Hollow Earth around 20 years ago and came across a book that referenced the first Earth picture from space as being taken from a satellite in 1967. The picture was published in the November of 67 issue of Life magazine. I went to the Toronto Reference Library and looked it up and found it. The reason the Hollow Earth author referred to the picture was because the picture showed flat spots at the poles, which the author maintained were caused by the polar openings into the Hollow Earth. And we'll finish that later when we come back from the break. Stay tuned.
No hype, no fear.
You're listening to Truth Frequency Radio.
We are TFR.
Strange World. I'm your host, Mark Sargent, and this is segment two of four. We're taking calls, we're taking emails, and the phone number for tonight is 720-897-6111. That is 720-897-6111. Hopefully we don't have too many technical difficulties. I've been kind of playing around with the voicemail settings just because I'm routing different things. But we'll get it eventually. No worries, guys. We'll figure it out. We were reading an email from Michael. He was talking about how he was in a hollow earth. He said, "Indeed, when I looked at the photo, the flat spots were there. Don't know what to make of it. If it was a faked image, did they flatten the poles as a red herring for conspiracy researchers? Better have them running around searching for hollow earth clues than to even contemplate the flat model. Any thoughts?" Mike Christie from Ontario, Canada. Interesting thought. Interesting. Let's see. It's a fairly big one. Randall writes, "Hey, RJ here. I've been creating my own concept of flat earth based on theories from both." Hey, I got a phone call coming in from 810. Hang on 1 second. And you are on live with Strange World.
Hey, Mark.
Hey.
Hey, it's Dave and the Thumb. How you doing?
I'm doing well. So what happened the first time when you called in? You just went straight to voicemail?
It went straight to voicemail. It did not ring.
Yeah, I had a button. I had a stupid button checked that said, if I'm on a call, go straight to voicemail. And I, of course, I didn't think that what I was on, 832, if you're calling in right now, I'm on a call. So call back and as soon as you hear me, get off, just so you know, because I'm not going to put you on hold or anything. I'm not going to add you to a group call. So anyway, what's going on?
Well, not too much. Just listening to your show, and I thought I'd, you know, give you a shout and let you know that, you know, why you couldn't get, anybody couldn't get through.
Oh.
So I sent you an email. I sent you a text.
I saw the text. Thank you. And did you leave a voicemail as well?
I did.
Yeah. That's great. No, thank you. Thank you. I very much appreciate it.
Okay.
If you don't mind, where are you calling from? Just so I can get, let.
I'm in the thumb of Michigan.
Right, the thumb of Michigan. How is it out there?
Yep. You know, it's a little chilly. It's been, we had some record lows in May 15th. We had to have some fires in our. We got a couple little apple orchards, and we had a, you know, hard freeze.
Nice.
And that was a record low temperature.
Got it.
And then the next week it was 88 degrees for like 5 days in a row.
Wow.
And then it went down. It went down to, it was down in the 30s again. And yeah, it's just so crazy.
All right. Well,
but it's Michigan, you know.
Yeah.
It's not like, you know, oh, global warming and all that crap. That's all, we all know that's a farce.
Yeah. Yeah.
And you know, it's climate change. I mean,
oh, yeah.
The climate change is every day here.
Yeah. I totally understand what you're saying. So,
right. All right. So anyway, yeah, cool show.
And thank you for reaching out to me in like three different ways.
Yeah.
That's awesome. No, I was going to figure out all eventually. Right. I shouldn't have probably messed with it like 10 minutes before the show started, but I was like, yeah. I got to try this. Why not? Right. People are going to be calling in. So
exactly.
What's the worst that could happen?
So I figured, hey, I'll try your other phone that you don't give the number out for. Is this for?
Yeah, and that's routed. That's routed straight through to this. So
okay.
So I'm doing that for a very specific reason, but I'm not gonna tell you guys why. So
no problem.
Yeah. All right, man. Well, hey, you have a good rest of your evening. Okay.
All right. You too. Great show.
Bye. Thank you.
Bye.
Bye. All right. Let's see here. Where were we? Based on the theories from both. Okay. I've been creating my own concept of flat Earth based on the theories from both round Earth and flat Earth ideas, as nothing has come close to what I've envisioned. Yet, out of all the debates I have heard, I have one question no one seems to cover, or has been flat, funny, pun intended, ignored. What does the Mayan culture say about the shape of the Earth? They have been proven to be astounding astronomers and have calculated events before and after their time on and off this Earth. Wouldn't they have something? So, my concept is in its infancy, and I am not educated in any scientific field. So here we go. Every tracking system we have currently in place can be explained by one ground-based technology. From GPS to flight navigation, with Nikola Tesla's research, this is achievable. Multiple Wardenclyffe-style towers allowed this to be possible. Being able to transmit massive amounts of various energy throughout the atmosphere in turn allows us to map by bouncing that energy off of it, including sending in horizontal lines. The triangulation effect comes from multiple towers and receivers. From what I can theorize, for the shape of the Earth, we are more the shape of a top, balancing. The Sun is in a pattern similar to a Celtic knot, weaving high above us in a 365-day, 5-hour, 48-minute, and 46-second-a-year cycle, according to our current calendar. With that concept, it allows the seasonal shifting to occur based on the position. The Moon is in a 27-day, 7-hour, 43-minute, again, current calendar, near circular pattern with a slight variant in distance. With the respective existential forces of magnetism and various radiations from each causing the top to wobble ever so precarious, this would put in motion the currents of wind and water, thus creating our weather patterns. Not bad. He goes on to say, so far, this is all I have come up with and would be interested to hear what you think. Thank you. Oh, yeah, it's not bad. That's an interesting model. I like it. It's still not a globe. Balancing top? I mean, you gotta remember, when I started this thing out, I thought, or I was leaning more towards the Orlando Ferguson line, which was that it was more of a roulette wheel type thing. But then I was told I could not say roulette wheel, because if you add up all the numbers on a roulette table, they add up to 666, which is true and weird. So take that for what it's worth. Christian Math writes, you need subtitles in French, if possible, for the Flat Earth clues. And the reason why I picked that email is because, yes, you're absolutely right, I do. And they are actually already out there. For those of you who don't know and have friends in other languages who you think the Flat Earth clues would be lost on, the clues were, I used the brand new, or it was new at the time, the YouTube translation program. So all you do is, if you have narrative, like I did, so I narrated all the clues, if you give them the narrative in text form, they can match it up. And then once it's matched up, it is automatically converted to all known languages. So all you have to do is log in. If your browser is set for French and you go to YouTube, then the subtitles will be in French, German, German, Spanish, Spanish, and the whole thing. So just have your friend log in, you know, or just log in from their home country. But if they're in the States, have them change their browser language to French. And when they log in, ta-da, there you go. The Flat Earth clues will be in French. Now, the audio won't be in French. If you want to hear the first chapter, I don't know how many more she'll do. We'll see. She's awfully busy, and that is Orphan Red. But it's on my channel. I do have at least one, the introduction of the Flat Earth clues, which is transcribed in French. Now, I am not reading it. It is done in a female voice. But if you're okay with that, then that's cool. All right, moving on. Ba-ba-ba. Good. Jack writes, "Good day, Mark. I went through your documentary with great interest. Unfortunately, I am unable to share it with friends." Oh, wait, this is the continuation of French speakers. "Your show mentioned subtitles." Oh, yeah, okay. So we answered that. It's from Jack. Sorry, Jack. Angeline writes, "Hey, Mark. Hope is well. I'm sure you already seen the recent video where Mark Zuckerberg interviews the three astronauts from the space station." Yes, I did. They list the Facebook Zuck videos 101, blah, blah, blah. "As I was watching this, many questions came to mind, but I wondered if you might know the answer to. This might be a dumb question, but how can sound travel at the exact rate in our environment as does in zero gravity environment? Wouldn't there be a difference of some sort? Just wondering, it just seems as though everything was as it would be on Earth during an interview. Also, did you notice the one guy holding up the telescope camera talking about looking out into space? How come they don't send any of those pictures? Thanks, Angeline." Yeah, good point on the pictures. No, they don't. They don't take pictures of anything docking. They just go low budget now. Everyone fills in the blanks with their own images. So they show as very little as possible. Any doubts of that, look at the lack of pictures from 1972 until the summer of 2015. There's one picture of the Earth from space. Combine that with everything, and I know I'm a broken record when I'm saying this, but the fact there's no astronauts turned around 180 degrees or further during a shot. No one did a 360 panorama on the moon. There's currently no pictures, no movies of the Earth rotating on its axis from space, and no geostationary orbits do not count. There is no movie cameras. There's no video of anything from that object leaving or entering Earth's orbit. They all cut out before 50 miles usually. The highest, I think, with a rocket ever was like 70 miles. Nothing has ever left the atmosphere and left the Earth, you know, firing off into the distance. No, it's never, ever happened. You'd think there would be, right? We could do it now, that's for sure. There isn't even a single picture of any astronaut inside an airlock opening the door and then leaving the airlock from the inside. Oh, yeah, you'll get a few outside shots, but not inside. What, you can't turn on a GoPro on an astronaut's helmet? They have GoPros. In fact, why aren't there – we have infinite memory now when it comes to GoPro cameras. Hard drives are so small and the stuff is so robust that they should have a camera running inside the helmet at all times. You don't even have to have an exterior helmet. Just have an interior one bolted, you know, just to the front. It would take 2 seconds to do. You know how small cameras are nowadays. Even for the general public, and they don't. There should be camera footage running, streaming all the time from an astronaut's helmet. when they're outside. Why, you know, inside, fine. You have personal issues. You don't want people to see. Outside, there should be no reason for it, unless you can claim, oh, Defense Department crap, whatever. I'm just not buying it. So, oh yeah, sorry, to answer your question about sound travel, the exact sound travel is based off of air and density of air. So, like, for example, look up, if you get a chance, Angeline, the speed of sound. The speed of sound is different. Oh, there's a call coming in from 845 area code. Hang on 1 second. You are on with Strange World.
Hey, Mark. It's Mark from New York.
Hey, hey, what's going on, man?
What's up, man? How are you?
Oh, pretty good.
That's what, cool. That's cool.
What's new?
Not much. Just calling in and say it's been an awesome week. No hem spraying. The skies have been blue. It's been awesome. Clear night. I'm looking at the moon and I'm wondering, why the hell is the shadow all wrong? You know, I had my son come out. He's 10. And I'm like, look at the moon. He goes, yeah. What causes the shadow? He says, well, the earth, heating away from the sun. I was like, okay, what's that over there? The sun. And he's just like, wait, how does that work?
Yeah.
You know, like, it's just incredible. Incredible.
Yeah. It's really great for me because I'm watching people nowadays that look so much more closely at the sun and the moon. All the time. People that, you know, because everyone took the moon for granted, you know, except for young couples. And it's like, oh, look, isn't it beautiful? We should take off our clothes. To, it's true. That's how it starts and that's how it ends usually. And
Absolutely. And
now it's everyone's just kind of, they're really staring at it. There's so many more people taking pictures and movies and they're just, you know, it's like trying to find something wrong with the moon and Crow 777 with his lunar waves. Everybody's been trying to find a lunar wave now. And fantastic. So,
hey, did you ever get to watch that weird show, Salvage One?
No, I really should.
It was very interesting. The first couple episodes, and they hit on programming heaven, everything. I was just like, holy crap.
Nice.
And I was about 12 when that was out. And I'm like, that's what did it. It was stuff like this that made me the way I was. You know, I said to the kid, I'm like, I'm 50 years old and I'm just starting to realize that all this stuff is BS. They're in line.
Yeah. Hey, you know, better late than never.
Absolutely.
And yeah, it's going to be part of my rant whenever I get into it, and which is, you know, because people say, well, you know, science doesn't lie to us. And I've got a rant that I'm going to build here that's, you know, basically science has lied to us all the time. I go, and the bigger the lie, the more motivation they have to lie. So in this case, it's like, look, do you really want to be the scientist that comes out and says, we lied about, we were wrong. We weren't just wrong. We were really wrong. I mean, we're wrong to the point this goes way beyond class action lawsuit. This goes,
that's the only way they could absolve themselves.
Yeah.
They're wrong.
Yeah, they're in trouble at this point. They don't know how exactly to turn it, except for, you know, the stuff they've been kind of feeding lately. It's like, oh yeah, you know, it could be virtual. It's like, really? That's what you're going to try to turn this to, virtual? I just don't see it.
Yeah, so, I don't know about that either. I mean, who knows? Maybe, but it just doesn't seem like that fit.
Yeah, I know. I hear you. Hey, by the way, what'd you think of the story? Did you hear that thing where the guy got in the fight and the round earther was the one that literally tried to blow the whole argument up by throwing a propane thing in the fire.
I love it. I love it. What was it? It is, like you said, or like the Bible said, even though I'm not religious.
But sure.
It always looked like a canopy to me. I said it to my dad when I was 8. He's like, you're out of your goddamn mind. I'm like, it looks like a roof, like a ceiling.
Yeah.
You know, at night, during the day, always. It's crazy.
Yeah, and I've looked at it. It was funny, and I think I've said this on other things, where I went up when I was looking at, you know, doing the UFO thing with night vision. And I was doing this years before I was doing Flat Earth. And there were a couple times, you know, because it takes a while for your eyes to get adjusted to night, you know, like 30, 40 minutes sometimes to really get set. And when my eyes were really set in and I was on my back staring straight up with night vision binoculars, there were some times I was looking, I was going, I'll be darned if it doesn't look like a freaking popcorn ceiling up there. I mean, it really looks textured. I hate to do this to you, but I got a guy that's trying to call in. So,
all right, cool.
But thanks very much, man.
I'm calling next week and tell you about experience I had that I think was maybe military now, not a UFO.
Nice. Let me know.
I'll call you next week.
Okay.
All right, cool. Bye. Okay. Have a good one.
All right. Hey, 562, if you're calling in, go ahead and call in again. Sorry about that. Anyone that's calling in, I've got you routing to voicemail, so you just don't hang around. So at least you can leave a voicemail if I'm not picking up. So thank you. And by the way, the phone number, we've got a few minutes before the next break, is 720-897-6111. That is 720-897-6111. So yeah, anyone that's been calling in so far, please do call in again. Unfortunately, I'm not going to, I like a lot of people, I'm not going to have guests stepping on each other. So you're just going to have to take your place in line. Oh, let's see here. Ryan Brown writes, simulation, flat earth making mainstream. It's starting to make mainstream news and InfoWars. And yeah, Alex Jones' show, not Alex himself, but one of his other teams, did do a thing because, as some people know, if you guys have been following, Neil deGrasse Tyson came out on a physics panel recently and said that the chances are that Earth is a simulation, even though all the other physicists on the panel, who I'm sure hate him, said otherwise. And he goes, no, it's absolutely. And then Elon Musk, the current founder, owner, whatever, of SpaceX, the NASA subcontractor, the private sector, he comes out, said the same thing like a week later. Says, oh, yeah, now was he parroting Neil deGrasse Tyson? We don't know. But those two together raise enough eyebrows that Alex Jones, who still will not do a Flat Earth show because their producers cannot figure out how to do a Flat Earth show without using the words Flat Earth, because they think if they mention Flat Earth that people will just turn off and they'll drop their subscriptions and it'll be horrible and awful. And I don't think that's true because I've been interviewed. I think this one I'm coming to on Saturday is like my 80th interview, and you know, everyone's still there. Well, that's not true. There were a couple people that wanted to make their last shows, some smaller shows, like wanted to make their last shows memorable. So they did Flat Earth at the end. I think I did two or three of those. But anyway, yeah, so check it out if you get a chance. It's I can't remember if it's the main YouTube channel, but Flat Earth. The Simulated Earth and InfoWars. You should be able to find it on YouTube and other places. And it's not that long ago either. This one was done, what's the date on this? This was done 10 days ago, so it should be easy to find. Anthony writes, hello, I finished your video and enjoyed it immensely. I see you did go with God, or at least implied it was he who built the dome for some reason. Despite the title, I swore you were going to go with aliens on that one. Maybe it was the technical nature which you described the necessary measurements and parameters of the dome. I guess if I were to imagine God in the traditional, more spiritual concept of the creator, thou creating the dome, it told be you less. Wow, I'm reading this as is, just so you know, guys. You less scientific and more mystical, like a giant encompassing force field of undiscovered and perpetual energy. What do you think of that? Do you have any more info on the topic or updates of the original info that Toy haven't had a chance to send out yet? I don't know what happened at the end of this. I think he was like doing shots as he was finishing up this email. Be associated, and thanks, pal. Keep the good work, and please keep us posted. Yeah, the dome could be made out of all sorts of fun things. Could it be a frequency based? Yes. Could it be a heavy element that we don't know? Yes. Could it be a heavy water element? That's what I'm kind of leaning towards now. I think that's more interesting, that that's potentially a heavy water, because Crow 777's been kind of looking at Brian Mullen with Balls Out Physics. He's been looking at it. Very, very interesting. So let's see here. The Yacht Guy writes, it's kind of a long one. We don't really have time for the second break before this one. You know what, just start it. We'll pick it up when we get back. So, hey, Mark, I've been enjoying your show. Your emphasis on the testimonies of professionals is brilliant. Great work. I found Mac's comments about the ADIRU anomaly particularly compelling. Critics of the flat Earth often cite aviation as concrete evidence that the Earth must be spherical. Like, the pilots would certainly know if the Earth were flat, and if it was, they would sound the alarm. Or so you'd have me believe that every pilot is in on the conspiracy. Mm-hmm. I was a helicopter pilot albeit for a short stint. And while there's a big difference between a Robinson R-22 helicopter and a 777, all us pilots learn from the same books initially. And with that, we're going to go break.
Frequency Radio.
The Wicked Ones, obviously under heavy Masonic influence.
Welcome back to Strange World, our second half of a two-hour show. And we're taking calls, we're taking emails. The phone number to call in is 720-897-6111. That number again, 720-897-6111. And I will answer them, not necessarily in the order you call. I know I'm getting voicemails, which is good because I'm actually testing out the voicemail system tonight. But if you call and you hear that I'm already on with somebody else, I'm not going to try to get them off. If you have something to say, I'm going to let you say it. And of course, if you like everything you hear during the show and you want to hear more about what I'm talking about, Flat Earth, check out my YouTube channel, which is Mark K. Sargent. And of course, go to marksargent.com, brand new website created by the same guys that did my apps, not the people that did my book, which is called Flat Earth Clues, The Sky's the Limit. On Amazon right now. Okay, so we were reading a letter from a guy who was a pilot. He was a helicopter pilot. So he said that he flew a Robinson R-22 helicopter. He goes, I can tell you that obtaining a pilot's license is a rigorous, challenging course of study during which students are hyper-focused on learning the material presented so that they can pass the FAA exam, get the ticket, and ultimately get that dream job. Much like medical doctors who know, believe, and practice only what their medical books and professors tell them, few pilots have the mental bandwidth or incentive for side projects like questioning the shape of the Earth. About avionics, I'm sure you know that pilots practice a technique called cross-checking. This is where you continuously compare the readings of related instruments to confirm the aircraft's status, condition, etc., and that the indicators are functioning properly. For example, if the artificial horizon indicates a nose-high altitude, the airspeed indicator should show a decay in airspeed. If not, it could mean something's awry. I sometimes ask pilots, if the Earth were a sphere, when cross-checking the... If the Earth is a sphere, when cross-checking the altimeter with the artificial horizon or the altitude indicator, wouldn't there be an apparent conflict? The artificial horizon should always show a nose-low condition while the altimeter remains steady, right? This usually gives them pause as they struggle to recall a textbook answer. I've never had a pilot concede, but the question plants a seed. Maybe that's the best we can hope for. Thanks for your work and a great show. The Yacht Guy. Thanks, Yacht Guy. That's awesome. Moving on to Goose 0307. What's up, Mark? Oh, I'm sorry, Gus. But is he? Whatever. What's up, Mark? My name is Gus. I live in Apple Valley, California, and I'm a flat earther. I stop telling people about flat earth because they think I need to see a psychiatrist. It really doesn't bother me, but I was wondering what is the next step to all of this. Well, Gus, the next step is eventually hitting, in my opinion, the 100th monkey effect, which is if enough people figure this thing out, then like the 100th monkey, then all of a sudden it becomes a topic that is commonplace. And if it becomes commonplace, that becomes very dangerous to the system. And really one of two things happens. Either because eventually it's gonna touch on people that are tied to a lot of money, most notably the military subcontractors, the people that are tied to NASA, and all the politicians that approve these funds. Because remember, if this isn't, you know, if the flat earth is true, then every dime that NASA has spent since 1958, and we're talking in adjusted dollars well over $1 trillion, that's a huge amount of money. All that money has been wasted, then somebody has to be accountable for that. There's a lot of fraud that has gone on here, and it'd be the biggest class action lawsuit in history. I don't think that's going to be allowed to happen because they can see it coming a mile away. And the American government is so tied to these industries, you know, Lockheed Martin and McDonnell Douglas and Boeing and Rockwell and all these guys, that they're just not going to let that happen. So what do you do in that case? You've got to help facilitate something else, another distraction, so that you can get off scot-free. That's what I see the authority trying to do. Now, if you want to think bigger picture, I think that whoever built this place, and if you want to call it the divine, if you want to call it an advanced civilization, you want to name it, you know, you want to do the whole Anunnaki or whatever, whoever is up there, a big golden spaceship shows up. That would have to be started by a trigger. And that means, regardless of what you think, this is a simulated reality or not, everything is based on triggers. It's basic programming, which is why I say that God is a programmer. You have automated systems. Anyone that knows programming, and it all comes down to really one phrase, which is if then go to. If this happens, then trigger this. That's all programming is just tons and tons of those statements. It's combinations and combinations of just those statements, and the trigger for this would be if enough people figure out where you live, somebody's going to have to intervene, because the system cannot function normally if everyone knows where they are. You know, you can't have an experiment where like a giant, you call it an animal preserve, you want to call it a terrarium, you want to call it a planetarium. If enough people figure out where they are, they're going to start acting strangely. Everyone's going to be looking up like there's a camera in the room and not act like they normally would. And that defeats the whole purpose, or at least part of the purpose, of why we're here. So that's why I think it's happening. That's where I think the awakening, where people are calling this a flat earth awakening, that's where I think we are now. We have moved to the point where the topic isn't just laughable. Now it's meeting the huge resistance where more people are fighting it tooth and nail, and people are coming over to the side. You got to remember, I wasn't kidding at the beginning of this, and there's nobody, with the exception of Tiger Dan, and Tiger Dan didn't even make it all the way through. No one who has gone down the flat earth road has turned against it. No one, officially, as far as I can tell. There hasn't been a single flat earther, and I don't think John LeBon counts. But Tiger Dan was the closest, where he actually said, oh, yeah, okay, I'm absolutely, even though he made 30 pro flat earth videos, never did take them down. They're still on his channel right now, Tiger Dan 925. He says, I'm going to make a 10-part series against flat earth. He only made 5. And after 5, you know, he said, oh, I'll deal with the Bible in like part 7. Then he disappeared. That was months ago. And never a word was heard from this guy. Yeah, rumors are that, yeah, he comments on this channel and that channel. No one's seen him on video. No one's talked to him. We don't know who's running his channel. He could be dead for all we know. We have no idea what happened. Point is that nobody has recanted in their testimonies. No one has gone against flat earth who was for flat earth. Now, debunkers, sure. Of course, there's debunkers that go against flat earth. But there's no one that has become a flat earther has become an anti-flat earther. Which would be, if you want an example of that, would be on another topic, that would be Joe Rogan. And again, I'm not condemning him, calling him a horrible person. I'm just saying he was against Apollo. He was against the entire NASA program. And then one day he became pro-NASA. Did not say why. He won't say why. And that's because he was compromised. There you have it. It's kind of a long answer to a very short email. Joanna writes, what does she write? Thank you, Mark, for all you're doing to get the word out. Questions. So Qantas Air is showing direct flights in the Southern Hemisphere. Are they real flights or just misleading? Duh. Okay, I'll answer that. I'll answer the stuff in order. Yeah, Qantas Flight 64 was the entire reason I made Clue 9, which was a follow-up to Clue 7, which was the long haul. Clue 9 was the magic show, which was, it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter if the flights are real or not because the flights are not being tracked. They drop off the GPS system. As soon as any flight, it doesn't matter if it's the Northern Hemisphere or the Southern Hemisphere, as soon as they get over water, 150 miles, 200 miles max, latitude and longitude disappear. Oh, yeah, you can still see the graphic, but if you click on that plane, it'll go into estimated or approximated mode, and you can't tell me with 32 or 36 or how many GPS, and that's just the GPS system that's supposedly up there. All those satellites, Department of Defense satellites, should have multiple blanket coverage. Why aren't those planes being tracked? Why not? So I don't care if the Qantas flight is real or not. Second question, does the ISS orbit the Earth with people in it? No. No, it does not. There's something up there. I mean, could it be a modified U-2 plane with holographic imaging? I don't know. Possibly. It wouldn't surprise me at all. I know there's something up there. No question. I have seen something flying up there myself. Do I think there's people in it? No, because if they're faking the interior footage of the internal space station, again, look up ISS hoax. That's all you have to do on YouTube. And watch just how many hours of movie. It's been broken down at such a fine level now that what I'm getting at is if you're faking the interior footage, you're faking it because you can't put people up there. And the only reason you couldn't put people up there now is because you can't. It's not that you don't want to. It's not that you don't have the money for it. It's that you can't. And why can't you? Because you can't get into orbit with people. There's something up there stopping you, and the world is not what you think it is. This past August, I did a visit to Kennedy Space Center and saw up close the space shuttle and hundreds of other things. I did see the ISS does not orbit over the North or South Poles. Admiral Byrd stated several people were with him back in the 1950s on his expeditions. Are there other documented testimonies? No. Not that I know of. Also, where can I purchase the Flat Earth model and posters? Just look up online. You'll be able to. Chris Pontius sells an interesting one. Look up that. Chris, C-H-R-I-S, P-O-N-T-I-U-S. He sells a cool Flat Earth model. Joel Zimmerman paints some really cool. Look up Joel Zimmerman Flat Earth paintings. There's some really good stuff there. Thanks so much. I'll be listening to you, Joanna Hayden from Hermiston, Oregon. Thank you, Joanna. Phone number to call in, 720-897-6111. That is 720-897-6111. Brad writes, hey Mark, I will start off this email by stating the obvious. Beyond a month ago, I thought nothing even close to the idea that our Earth could be flat. It was never even a thought process for me. Like everyone else, I just accepted what I thought to be true. I've been watching endless Flat Earth videos since then and just absorbing all of the information. It's been mind-blowing to say the least. I'd like to also state that I don't have any religious background, but that I'm open to the idea of it all. I guess I would be classified as agnostic. Help me out if I'm wrong on that one. And...
did Mark?
Yes, can you hear me?
Yeah, Mark, Dave Holmes here.
Hey, Dave, how are you?
Good, good. I'll be brief. You're the busiest guy in the world.
That's okay. Do you? I know you're calling. The call was forwarded to the radio show, so I think you're live. So is it okay?
Oh, is that right? Lucky
yeah.
You.
Yes, yeah, sorry about that. Are you? Would you mind if we include this? You want me to edit it out after the show?
No. You're welcome to include my thoughts.
Sure. Shoot. What do you got?
Yeah. All right. Go ahead. Do you want me to add some thoughts or you want to ask me any questions?
You've been leaving me so many voicemails recently. Your thoughts would be great.
Okay. I think some of the hottest material that you've ever presented is this issue, this conversation about non-player characters.
Yes.
And I look at it this way. There's consciousness in every square millimeter of the universe. This is my view currently.
Okay.
It's subject to change as I evolve. But look at these other beings, not as permanently in that state. They are seeds or unhatched eggs, you might say. Now, they haven't reached self-realization. But those like you and I and people who are questioning the programming that we've received throughout our lives, those that are capable of doing that critical thinking and choosing to change the program, maybe we're part of a graduating class. That's not to say others can't get here, but they are playing their role right now as automatons.
That is so weird that you would bring that up, because I was thinking this just the other day, because I got in that discussion with, you know, about NPCs and on air, and I was talking about it, and I was going, you know, maybe I'm thinking this too simply, and that is, what if NPCs had levels just like anything else does? And once you got to a certain point, what if the NPCs actually became more than themselves, more than the original programming? Is that what you're kind of hitting?
That's exactly where I'm going with this, Mark.
Yeah.
That is the hope. You know, perhaps the original progenitor, God, whatever you want to call them, maybe they wanted company so badly that they threw out these sparks of consciousness. And they could only imbue so much life into these seeds. Those seeds had to sprout on their own to become real company, good company for the creator or the creators. They had to walk their own path. They had to reach the yang moment. I describe in some of my thinking here, yin is awareness. Mm-hmm. This is the two compartments of consciousness, yin and yang. The yin would be the awareness part of consciousness. The yang is the power of decision to change your awareness.
Yeah.
And one of my great mentors describes that as not awareness, but awareing. When you are fully active, self-realizing, you are now in a position to change the way you see the world. Up to this point, though, something higher than us is reading our thoughts, our expectations. They know precisely what our context and our sphere of possibilities are. They don't throw UFOs in our face all the time, because they know that's a little bit beyond our current reach of expectation or probability.
Yeah.
But that doesn't mean it isn't sitting out there in the sphere of possibility. But they keep it just a little further ahead. Another statement that I've made once, Mark, is that this place was designed to be a little crazy. How do you make pearls? You irritate the oyster with a little irritant, a piece of sand or something. It is the absurdity of this world that compels us to look for home.
Nice.
It's wired. If it was too perfect, then you'd just stay asleep.
Interesting. Well, I'm going to steal from the Matrix on that one. Where it said, did you know the original Matrix was designed to be a perfect world where none suffered?
Oh, is that so?
And everyone was happy. Yeah, it was from the first Matrix from 1999. And he goes, it was disaster. No one would accept the programming. It was like a dream that your primitive cerebrum kept trying to wake up from, which is why it was redesigned to this, because human beings define the reality through misery and suffering. I totally agree with that. Yeah, that's fantastic. That's great. And it's funny, because I was thinking about this. I was going, because I was thinking about all the NPCs I've played with over the last, 15 years since they've really been around. Mm-hmm. And I was thinking, there's some NPCs that I really, I really liked, and I want them to be more. I want to keep hanging out with them. And I was wondering, it's like, what if they could become more? And some people actually, in like some of the mods and the add-on programs, they developed very complex NPCs by our standards. And, it all comes down to programming. I thought that's great. I'm so happy you brought that up.
Well, you see, intelligence isn't enough. you see, an NPC can become profoundly intelligent, can
sure.
be highly educated and schooled in science, philosophy, etc.
Yeah.
But until it says, I know who I am a non-physical consciousness, and I can choose my mood, my thoughts, my feelings, and my higher self, who's been with me the whole time,
yeah.
will add unto us. Seek ye first the kingdom of God, and all else will be added unto you. Well, seek those higher thoughts,
yeah.
is the way I see it.
Yeah.
But now, what is capable of tracking with our thoughts and our expectations? What can read our minds and our hearts so intimately that it knows what reality is appropriate to who we are and what we're thinking and what our chronic emotions are and expectations are? It would have to be us. It
yes.
would have to be a something that is us, or maybe we're extensions of that progenitor, whatever. That's getting, I mean,
yeah.
I often thought of the universe as a complex multi-level marketing campaign.
Yeah.
You'd have your upline, but that's, you know, it has to be something like that. There has to be something higher that's tracking with us. And, but yeah. you know, it, as you get older, mm-hmm. and I have a granddaughter mm-hmm. up on Kamena Island, by the way, up in your part of the woods. Mm-hmm. And something I thought about the other day, Mark, I said, I've achieved enough in my life and I've satisfied enough of my desires. It's changed me. Now I want to live through others a little more and extend that thought out 1,000 times, 10,000 times. How do the higher realms, assuming you believe there's higher beings, mm-hmm. how would they behave? Would they be asserting themselves upon us all the time? I don't think so.
No.
I think the tendency, Mark, would be for them to say, okay, you take the reins. It's just like an adult playing with a child. Mm-hmm. The adult tends to let the kid set the tempo, and the adult will play along.
Yeah.
And I think that may be the case here. But there's a deeper hope. There's a complex hope in being so old and wise and they can see the whole horizon. Mm-hmm. And that is, okay, they want to have fun with us, and they want us to grow, but they want us to become stronger and wiser and deeper and more mature. But we have to develop our yang, our ability to choose.
Yeah.
Because what good is it to have a counterpart who just does what it's told to do? Is that really love?
Yeah.
And those beings that you've met throughout your life, you could look in their eyes and say, I know there's something, someone there. What you're sensing, I believe, is the potential.
Yeah.
Yes, they are conscious, but they aren't wise like you are. You're a graduate, Mark. My God. I mean, if anybody's going to graduate from this matrix this time, you're certainly in the graduating class.
Well,
you wouldn't
you.
Be doing what you're doing without exploring this level of depth and
yeah.
of thinking.
Thank you. Go ahead.
And the flat Earth, is just another layer of the onion. And you see, this onion can only be peeled from the inside out. That means you're alone in there. You're digging your way out of this thing.
Yeah.
And the flat Earth discovery is a layer along the way.
Yeah.
And then you say, well, what's after flat Earth? Well, my God, it's a dream.
Yeah.
And if it's a dream and I have the ability to choose, well, maybe I can modify it. Now you're dancing, you're waltzing with your higher self.
Yeah.
You say, well, let's dance a little this way. Let's change the tempo a little bit.
Yeah.
You see, I think we're really on to something here. Yeah, but when you look in the eyes of these, you know, simple-minded souls,
yeah.
there's someone there, but not someone there that you can understand. You're going to love them more than they're going to love you because they, just like a child, the parent always adores the child.
Yeah.
Much more than the child could ever, you know, reciprocate.
Yeah. It just...
You had something...
Yeah, it takes time and the right choices. It all still, yeah, it comes down to the choice. And what you were saying is so true, which is we have to make, you know, nobody that creates this, you know, us, they don't want mindless automatons. They want people that make their own choices and make the choices they want, of course. You know, there's an element of risk there. you know, you want us to make the right decisions and live the right lives and make them proud, but you don't want it to be so forced that it's like, well, if they did it just because I said so, you know, that's not going to help
me. That's right. Yeah. You if you're God, you want someone to love you because they choose to, not because they're programmed to do so.
Yeah.
And what better way to make the universe so incredibly and richly complex and random is to throw out googles and googles of seeds, little sparks of consciousness, mm-hmm. with the basic programs, which is I'm aware that I exist, and I'll tell you that is the most certainty you'll ever have.
Yeah.
Is that I know I exist, but I'm not absolutely sure about these others. But you know, it's always good to give others the benefit of the doubt, and I think that's a good protocol and decorum. Give them the benefit of the doubt.
Yeah.
Yeah. And yes, sir. They may be acting like non-player characters, but you don't know who they're going to be.
Yeah.
Down the line, and they could sprout. Not all seeds sprout.
Good point.
And I can only imagine what happens to those. I'm sure there's some benevolent recycling program for consciousnesses and little sparks or souls that never choose to say, I'm going to craft my reality rather than accept what I've been offered.
Yeah.
And that's what makes this group of yours that you're forming.
Yeah.
That's what makes it part of the graduating class, and what an exciting group of people!
Yeah,
they are. Oh my God, the experience, because you can't possibly swim against the current.
Yeah.
Of everything NASA's thrown at us in the schools and everything, unless you're really ready.
Yeah.
To say, you know what? It's time. Hey, when does a little chick hatch?
Good point.
It,
oh,
it
hey.
Hatches,
I hate to do this to you, Matt, but we're going to break. You want to hang on for a minute?
That's all I got for now. I'll talk to you later.
Okay, talk to you soon.
Bye. Bye-bye.
We are TFR.
My faith in destiny is all I need to prevail.
Truth Frequency Radio.
Welcome back to Strange World. I'm your host, Mark Sargent, and this is segment 4. And yes, that was Joe Jackson, and that was stepping out from his album, Night and Day. And with us, we have a caller. Are you on with us, caller?
Yeah, Mark, right here. This is a hijacker.
Hey, man, what's going on?
Oh, not much. Listen, I wanted to get your take. Well, first off, let me preface what I'm getting ready to say.
Mm-hmm.
So before 9/11 happened, you had preachers, you had truth tellers, you had, you know, different people, scholars, journalists, everything. Mm-hmm. But then once 9/11 happened, it created a 9/11 spiritual vortex in which either you joined up with the lie, believing that it was 19 hijackers, or you became on the other side, and you knew it was an inside job, and you knew basically who did what and, you know, how it went down. And so you caught up to the true narrative. However, it was a vortex in the sense that it just devoured so many preachers, journalists, professors. I mean, so many people in government had to go along with the lie just to protect their life. Well, this is the odd thing about the flat Earth. Flat Earth has turned into a flat Earth spiritual vortex. And now, after you got that division with the 9/11, which basically devoured people, just sucked them right down that vortex, reduced honorable men, preachers, reduced their lives to a lie. Now the flat Earth spiritual vortex has divided the truth-telling community. And so this is what I wanted to get your take on. Mm-hmm. So I heard a debate between two truthers. Both of them were all down with 9/11. Yeah, they knew about Sandy Hook, the Boston bombing, they knew about all the stuff.
Yeah.
However, one was a flat earther and one stuck to the globe. And so there was an hour and a half debate between David Wise and I can't think of who the other guy was.
Was it just recently the Postal Service?
Right. There you go. There you go.
Yeah.
You're up on it.
Yeah.
So I watched and, being a flat earth master warrior like yourself, we can basically take anybody apart. I mean, it doesn't matter who it is. We know we can take pretty much anybody apart. But I was wondering why David, he didn't do real well in that debate. And about midway through, the postal guy, he jumped David about Eric Dubé and Nazism and David Wise Jewishness.
Mm-hmm.
And then David just, I don't know what happened in the debate, but he just kind of collapsed. Did you hear the debate?
I didn't. I saw the reviews on it, and I know what you're talking about. Yeah, I didn't make it to the second part. I unfortunately, there's so much stuff I have to review. I thought he was going to be kind of, just doing his thing, but the Postal Service was jumping onto that in follow-up videos saying that he didn't do well in the second half, and that, I mean, who knows? I mean, David could have been drinking, or for what I know. Why? What was your take on it? That he just started kind of losing focus?
I think what happened, because David Wise was Jewish and he's sensitive to that.
Yeah.
That, but this is my point, is that this postal guy, mm-hmm. even though he was a truther,
yeah.
I listened to him very carefully because I knew what I would have said in David's stead, and I realized, wait a minute, this guy is trained. He knows the truth. This guy is actually an op. I mean, he is a shrill for NASA.
Mm.
He was too clever. He had too many arguments down. I mean, he was actually beautiful on the battlefield when he went up against David, even to the point to where he invoked Eric Dubé and the Nazism, and then hit David that you're Jewish and yet you're for this guy who's pro-Nazi. And of course, David just went to pieces after that. He just kind of shut down.
In fact,
David was asking to get out of the debate about a dozen times. I've
really?
Had enough of that. Oh, yeah, yeah. That's never happened with a flat earther. Flat earther can stay around for 10 hours.
Yeah, I was about to say. I'll have to listen to this now. I'm a little surprised.
But my take on it was, it seems to be that the people in the truth movement,
mm-hmm.
Like Jones, like so many truthers,
yeah.
Especially Christians like Ken Hovind,
mm-hmm.
What is up with these guys? You know they know the earth is flat.
Yeah.
Why? What is a schism which prevents so many of them from coming through? I mean,
I'm not sure either. There's a line there that's been drawn, and I don't know who drew it, and I don't know who has talked to who. The only two people, of course, I can attest to, one would be Alex Jones, because his team doesn't know what to do with it. They want to do a show on flat earth and they can't figure it out because they're scared to death. But Alex,
we think that they let him out of prison and they told him, look, you're going to get out of prison, have a good life. Yeah, your wife left you and you're going to have all these problems, but this is a deal. No flat earth. You hold the line on that, because once people get flat earth, they wake up to the whole matrix, the whole world system, the Luciferian system,
yeah.
Evolution. They wake up to the whole thing.
Yeah.
And actually, there's a bigger truth than the flat earth, which is just over the horizon, which I'm not going to go into. But anyways, Mark, I just wanted to get your take on what happened, because it just...
Oh, well, now I'm going to have to revisit it. I mean, he and I haven't actually spoken since then, and usually, yeah, I've watched him tear it apart, but it could have been every once in a while... you know, with anyone that debates anybody, if you prep well enough against your guy, whoever it is, you know, it's not that you're prepping against the whole flat earth scenario. You're prepping just against that guy. Sometimes you can take some shots and land them when they're not ready for it. So maybe that's what
I mean, even on your clues about the long haul flights, you know, he hit David with it about the airline only takes so many hours, and
sure,
you know, David had a hard time with that, and I'm sitting here thinking, David, can you mention the Concorde? You know, in 1970, we had a Concorde jetliner that could do 1,500 miles an hour.
Yeah.
Would you like to mention that, David? But he just was, I think he hit him with the Jewish stuff, Eric Dube, and the Nazi stuff,
and
I think he shut down. Yeah.
Could have been. I mean, he could have caught him in a certain mood. It's like, man, I'm not going to deal. I mean, if you hit anybody personal enough, you know, they're going to react certain ways. And, you know, maybe he just wasn't, you know, didn't want to, you know, engage him as much as others. Maybe he thought, it's a loss. This guy's an idiot anyway. Who knows?
Oh, yeah. Well, not me. I mean, and also I found a way of breaking. It's foolproof, actually. If you get into a chat room and you get the ball earthers come up against you and they go, okay, well, the earth is not moving, such and such. I found out, don't argue with them. Just keep adding more evidence because we got a mountain of it.
Yeah.
So if you keep on adding more evidence, I just link them sometimes to you, Mark, and then they won't talk to me no more because they realize I'll just keep linking or just keep adding more arguments. And they go, this is not working. And you can shut down a ball earther or a NASA shrill.
Yeah.
But great show, Mark. Thanks for taking my call.
All right.
And you're doing great.
Man. Talk to you soon.
Take care. Bye.
Bye. All right. Well, where were we before this whole thing started? Let's see here. I was reading an email from Brad. Let's just start it again. Hey, I'll start off this email by stating the obvious. Beyond a month ago, I thought nothing even close to the idea that our Earth could be flat. It was never even thought process for me. Like everyone else, I just accepted what I thought to be true. I've been watching endless flat Earth videos since then and just absorbing all of the information. It's been mind-blowing, to say the least. I'd like to also state that I don't have any religious background, but that I'm open to the idea of it all. I guess I would be classified as agnostic? Help me out if I'm wrong on that one. I'm just a guy who questions everything he's told and always looks at both sides of the coin. And to be honest, there is just way too much information and proof shown to me to believe anything other than the fact that we've been lied to all of our lives. I love listening to your podcast and how you guys break down things down for anyone to understand the facts. So two things. First, now that I know the Earth curvature math, I've been doing some research of my own. Second, I have photographic proof to back it up.
Oh, yeah?
I'm an aspiring photographer that mostly shoots nature. Back in March, I went out to various locations around my city and shot some awesome photos. And it wasn't until tonight that I looked at a couple with certain degree of disbelief. I live in Victoria, British Columbia. Hey, that's really interesting because I know people in Victoria, British Columbia. So essentially, we have an awesome view of the Juan de Fuca Strait from numerous points in town. I know this to be true. I actually stood on a mountain recently and looked at the Juan de Fuca Strait, or the Strait of Juan de Fuca. In two of my photos, I captured shots of both Mount Baker in Washington State as well as Port Angeles. Now for the kicker. I searched online for these exact distances between Victoria and these places and came up with some interesting math. From Victoria to Port Angeles is roughly 24.85 miles, which would mean 293 feet below the horizon. From Island View Beach to Mount Baker, so the distance straight across the water, 124 miles, which would mean 9,600 feet should be below the horizon. Mount Baker is 10,780 feet tall, which means that only 1,000 feet should be visible from where I took the photo, but yet I can see most of the mountain range with ease. Mark, I'm still trying to adjust this mental shift in perspective, but thus far I've had my mind blown by the stunning information you presented. Attached are the two photos that I mentioned, and in them you see clear as day what I'm describing. Feel free to share these with your audiences for further proof. All the best. Thank you. That's awesome. And the fact that you brought Victoria into it. Beautiful place, by the way. Kendrick writes, good day. I'm writing you because I've been watching your video and think it's very informative with great evidence. I just want to thank you for your research and dedication. Blessings. That reminds me, somebody wrote me an email recently, and I don't want to forget it. And that is Need Info. I think it's this one. They asked me basically about dinosaurs. And I don't think I took their call. So let me, they wanted me to address it real quick, and I wanted to ask real quick. Basically, they want to know, do I believe in dinosaurs? What's my take on dinosaurs? Because some people are saying that dinosaurs are completely fake. I don't think they're completely fake. I think they're just an earlier version of this place. So if we're version 6.0, the dinosaurs would probably be in version like 2 if the continents and all the light systems were designed or kind of modified in version 1. And the continents were all those just big supercontinents in the middle of the plate. Like called Pangaea, dinosaurs would have been the first version or the second version. So that do I believe in dinosaurs? Yes, I do. I just don't think that they were millions of years old. I think that they were around and they were a version with a different type of atmosphere and maybe a different type of gravity, and you know the world was a very, very different place. But I do think they were real. I don't think they were completely fabricated. There's just way too many little ones and big ones and you know, fish that are some that are extinct and some that aren't. And I believe, you know, in the plesiosaur that could be swimming around some of the freshwater lakes, you know, otherwise known as the Loch Ness Monster. I think the plesiosaur could be real. There's something swimming in there. And it begs the question. That the reason why you're not going to see a lot of scientists spending a ton of money trying to find it is because if they found it, that's a paradox right there. If you find the Loch Ness Monster, that opens up a huge can of worms that science doesn't want to answer, which is the carbon dating system. Because if these things should have died off hundreds of millions of years ago, how the heck are they living in a lake that, you know, has gone through different things, and how are they not overpopulating the lake, and why aren't there more dinosaurs? And, you know, so the question is, you know, are they only thousands of years old and they survived one of the previous cataclysms? Or did somebody who was building the dome have some fun with us and drop in one of the older species? It could be any of the three, to be honest. But I do think there's something there. So, before we get to the next one, let's do real quick the phone number again. 720-897-6111. That is 720-897-6111. And yes, for someone who was just chatting with me recently, that was from the website question. That's what it was. And he asked me, and I also mentioned it to him in the chat room. And that website was marksargent.com. And yes, I'm going to plug it since we're in the last segment. If anyone wants to go there, it is my my big site, which is free trial going on. It is a subscription site, but it's a free 30-day trial. And if you don't like it, hey, throw it back. It's a catch and release if you don't like it, but I think you'd like it because there's exclusive content on there that you will not find anywhere else, not on YouTube, not anywhere, unless somebody rips it and then puts it up somewhere. But I'm not going to find them. If you guys want to be mean, that's fine. Anyway, let's get back to the emails because we have a few more, and I don't think we're going to make through all of them before the break, but that's fine. Let's see here. I don't think I can pronounce his first name. Solmen, S-O-U-M-E-N. Interesting thing, he was talking about the Antarctic Treaty on Wikipedia. Interesting thing, you probably already noticed, the Wikipedia page for the Antarctic Treaty does not have any reference to conspiracy theories or anything of that nature, but other things, including Barack Obama's birth certificate, place of birth, as well as Bigfoot, and various things related to UFOs, are mentioned on Wikipedia. So why would they not say a word about flat Earth theory on that particular Wikipedia page when the Antarctic Treaty has been referenced so many times in relation to the mother of all conspiracy theories? Why not have a single sentence about references to the treaty in pop culture? Good point. And again, you know, this is the not only is it the mother of all conspiracies, it's the most hidden of all conspiracies. You can talk about any conspiracy you want, you know, 9/11, Bigfoot, Loch Ness Monster, JFK, Pearl Harbor, Sandy Hook, Boston bombing. I just keep going. But flat Earth? No, you can't talk about that. Why not? It's two words, and it's supposedly 500 years old. So, and outdated. It's an archaic religious belief. It's scientific heresy. What are you talking about? Why? Yeah, but you're not allowed to talk about it. You got to wonder why. Mark, I am from Oceanside, California, right outside of Camp Pendleton. I was an EOD tech in the Marine Corps and medically retired a few years ago. I found myself listening and watching a lot of conspiracy type shows and came across your YouTube channel. It wasn't the first time I've heard of the Flat Earth Theory, and I definitely think that we are kept in the dark about so much, and it's very frustrating to know we are constantly being lied to. I do have a question about your theory. Keep in mind, I haven't had a chance to listen to or watch much of your content as of yet. I just listened to you explain how stars are projected and how they are visibly different based on geographical location. Thousands of years ago, stars in the sky were charted. How, based on the limited technology, the stars a projection? How are the eclipses explained in the flat Earth theory? Eclipses and the stars, the same thing. It's part of a display system. Now, you're thinking for a second there that maybe the stars are based on like one of our display systems. No. I think they're based on whoever created this place, no different than a planetarium. And so, yes, I do think that stars' positions and how they are portrayed to us are based on not only could they be based on geographical location, but they could also be based on your individual location. You look up instances in programming, and which is the realization of an object, which means whatever is observable around you is only unique to you. So where you are on one end of a canyon and your friend is on the other end of a canyon, you both look up, you're supposed to think you're seeing the same stars of Orion, in which case you're actually seeing two completely different stars of Orion, but they look identical to you. So you could both take pictures and show them to each other and say, yeah, they look exactly like this. But in instances, you can do anything you want. So when it comes to the sky and eclipses and stars and comets, there is no limit, and planets. There's no limit to what you can do there. No different than in a planetarium. You got to remember, when they're planetariums, when they're not showing planets and stars up in the planetariums, they're showing laser light shows, or at least they used to, like Laser Floyd and Laser Led Zeppelin. They used to do rock shows and just show a whole bunch of really cool images. You can do drugs and stare up the ceiling. What do you think that was? You know, there's literally no limit to what you can do with sky technology. It's just a question of if you believe that when you walk out of a planetarium, that you're not in a bigger planetarium. Just saying. Oh, I got a few minutes left before the end of the show. Paul Sinclair writes, hey, mate, we haven't met, but I just watched your video on YouTube. Most enlightening and very informative. I read a lot by David Icke and have always known deep down that our modern day reality is BS. A flat earth is new to me, but nonetheless interesting. Where did this start for you? What turned you on to it? I have flown many times in the south and the equator, and the anomalies are manifest. If you can find the time, could you please send me some more links and information to check out? Many thanks for your hard work and brilliant presentation. Regards and respect, Paul. I'm not going to answer what I started into this and what turned you on to it. You can listen to one of the 77, going to be 78 soon, interviews that are on YouTube. Because everybody asks me that. Just listen. It's in the first usually 10, 15 minutes of any of the interviews. And I think it's also in my bio. And so have fun with that. And anyone that wants more links, I usually refer them to the Flat Earth Shortlist, which is on my YouTube channel, Mark K. Sargent. If you want people, that's a great cross-section of people that have also done YouTube videos on the Flat Earth that aren't me. I mean, yeah, I think I've got one or two in there now, but most of them are from other people. They vary in range of depth, from super, super simple. I mean, one of them's done by an 8-year-old girl. How deep could that be? And another one's done by an engineer. So have fun with that. We can crank through this one real quick. Skeeter writes, hey, Mark, I've been studying Flat Earth for about 10 months now. I've also listened to many of your interviews with subject experts. Recently, a news article about the opening of the world's longest underground rail tunnel, the Gothard Base Tunnel in Switzerland, 35 miles long, caught my attention. Aside from the strange cultic ritual opening ceremony, I thought to inquire as to whether you've interviewed anyone with the knowledge of how they would compensate for Earth curvature while tunneling through the Alps. A different example is the Delaware Aqueduct, which is 85 miles in length, up to 2,500 feet deep in bedrock, built around 1945. Also true. No need to respond, but this is a sensible question. Maybe it'll be addressed in one of your future shows. Thanks, Ty. Ty, you're absolutely right. It's a great question. How do they compensate for this? Because every surveyor that I've talked to, every engineer that I've talked to, anyone that's doing anything when it comes to building anything, they all say the same thing, and that is nobody compensates for any curvature whatsoever. You treat your project like the world is perfectly flat, which is interesting because we all know it's not perfectly flat, right? So that's the contradiction. So it's like the pilots that are up in the air. They all know the world, the horizon they look at, it looks perfectly flat. But it can't be flat, right? Can't be. Unless it is. Unless it's the greatest secret ever. That's what we're talking about. We're going to keep talking about it, and I'm going to keep talking about it. I'm going to keep hammering on this thing until it cracks wide open, and whoever built this place decides to intervene. That's my big mission. 100th Monkey Effect. Get God to show up. Anyway, treat others better than you treat yourself, guys.
Call me.